Hello, Victor Nyren here. It's been a while since I last made a video where I speaking, so I'm a little off. It will hopefully get better after a while. I'm not an English speaker, I'm a Swedish guy, so bear with me. It will be better after a while because, in some of my old videos I think I did pretty good, but it's been a few months since I last made a video where I spoke in English. So anyway, I have Total War Warhammer 2 that I bought during the summer of 2018. I only tried like a few battles back then I played it for a week or two in February, where I played Radius mod with lots of minor mods as well, and I liked the overall experience, but I never really finished the campaign or anything. I just played parts of some Dark Elven campaigns. I tried Murati, I tried Malekith, and I tried Hellebron. And then I played a lot of custom battles as well on custom siege battle maps, but I believe it's like Grand Campaign custom battle maps or something like that, or custom settlements, I'm not sure, but the mod basically adds a lot of custom settlements to the custom battles and to the campaign, because most of the vanilla settlements in this game is very they are very boring to play in, because they are all the same. And the developers didn't really put in an effort to make them exciting. Most of the settlements are outside of the actual playable battle map area, and the area where you can play is just very simple. It's like no effort was put in making cities unique, but fortunately modders have done a lot of custom battle maps. I believe it's over 40 battle maps, but still most of the siege battles will still use the vanilla ones, which means the developers of this game were lazy when it came to the siege battles. If you compare it to Rome Total War or Medieval 2 Total War, they did a much better job in those games. But the battle map battles are amazing, the animations of the units are amazing, etc. Let's check the mods that I have now. So I have the mod configuration tool. It will enable us to configure certain mods, because certain mods have one option enabled automatically, but if you have this mod configuration tool, then you can choose between alternate variations of the mods functions. Like for example, a mod where you can have legendary lords. If you don't have the mod configuration tool, then you will automatically get all the lords of your faction, all the legendary lords. For example, for the dark elves, that would be Murati and Malekith and Crone Hellebron and possibly Malice Darkblade and the fourth one, the one outside of the pirate coast. But if you have this on, then you can choose other options, like starting with just heroes, or starting with their regions and armies as well. And you can add additional options, like for example you want all the main legendary lords to band together for all the factions, so all the playable legendary lords from the dark elves will be one faction, all the playable legendary lords from the high elves will be one, etc., including their starting regions and armies. But the other ones, the insignificant extra lords, the ones that are placed into the game instead of rebels, they would still be AI. And then there is a world war option where all the dark elves are starting together and all the high elves are starting together, etc., etc. And that's the option I like, because that reminds me of how things are in Medieval 2, where you play as the entire faction. That means you have a lot of armies, a lot of regions, and a lot of legendary lords from the start. And you won't have to fight your own people, only if they rebel or something. Alright, so mod configuration tool. This is a tool for other mods that implements a standardized script-driven and multiplayer-safe UI for selecting options for mods you have installed, or for creating entire mods that implement more choices into the vanilla game. On the start of a new campaign, you will be presented by this UI. You will not receive the UI in existing games. You will eventually be able to change certain settings during the game, but this is an implementation challenge, so it isn't in 1.0. Compatibility: this mod is compatible with anything. This doesn't mean it has options for all mods, however. This mod requires an API-driven integration from other mods to enable options for them. If you're a mod author and want options for your mod, look for the API thread in the discussions page. I'm not a modder for Total War Warhammer 2 or any other modern game. The only Total War games I can mod are Medieval 2 Total War Kingdoms and Rome Total War. Those are very similar games. I'm a Medieval 2 modder, but I can mod Rome because it's very similar, even though I prefer to mod Medieval 2, because there are some differences and I'm not that used to the differences. But everything that is the same is, of course, easy. Alright, I have the Legendary Confederations. Originally, I was very disappointed with the function because I wanted to play as the entire. I wanted to play as all the lords and their regions. But when I started the game, I only had Malekith, Helebron, and Murati as starting heroes, but I didn't get their regions or their armies. But then I read this text more closely. You can read it for yourself, and if you have that mod configuration thing, then you can enable all these things. For example, tell your new team, decide which legendary lord join your forces. Is Skarsnik not part of Grimgor's new wag? Is Tyrion's call for aid disregarded by Alitana, your choice, or Theatres of War? Regular confederations, you gain not just the legendary lords but also their respective territories, both near and far away. Consider them outposts to either keep or raise. So, and I'm using these extra mods to the abandoned region mod, which enables us to abandon a region. Alright, then Deadly Alliances mode, set the stage for World War Warhammer. The AI legendary lords will also confederate regular way and form their own power blocks. Team Dark Elves led by Malekith, Team Lizardmen led by Mastamundi, Team Dwarves led by Torgrim, and so on. That's really cool. So yeah, we are using that. The expanded roster for the Amazons are not used. The actual Empires are not used because it isn't compatible with other mods that I'm using. Unbreakable alliances and vassals. That's very good. Summary. The mod allows you, your military defensive allies and vassals, to safely refuse requests to join wars without worrying about breaking the alliance. The mod simply removes the ability to break off alliances when declining to join wars as the player or AI. That's awesome, but I'm not sure it works because I think I tried it with its on and it still would break the alliance when I declined to join an ally of the day. Declared war on someone, but we still have it on and hope it works this time. I placed it higher up on the ladder now, but if you're unfortunate, then it might not work. For example, one, you will no longer be dragged into multiple wars by your allies. Two, Norskan vassals will not break off their vassalage even if they refuse to join your wars if you're playing as Chaos. 3. If the AI declares war on you and you have a ton of allies who declined to the call of war, they will still continue to be your allies despite their refusal. Alright. I wanted to use the SFO overhaul mod, but it's still in it's still updating, so I can't use it for now. So we're using Radius instead, but I like the idea of this mod having every unit balanced. So instead of having over 200 new units, that where a lot of them are the same, with different looks, instead we have a mod here where every unit counts. It does add some new units, but for the most part it focuses more on like balance. So for example, giant units will be fewer in number but will be much stronger than they are otherwise, and will be a real danger on the battlefield, which I like. And as for the ordinary units, they made sure that all the units have a role to play. In the vanilla game, for example, if you played as the Dark Elves, I haven't played the vanilla game myself, but I watched Legend of Total War play as the Dark Elves, as Malekith, and when he spammed Dark Shards, the crossbowman unit of the Dark Elves, then he could win against any odds pretty much, because the crossbowmen were overpowered, so he basically didn't need other units, he only needed crossbowmen. But in this mod they made all the units count, so I don't think you can win with simply spamming crossbowmen anymore. Alright, Banner Overhaul 2. It's a mod. Banner Overhaul 2 replaced all the banners, unit icons, faction names and faction selection screen. Thought that was cool. No mass route. That's cool. This is a very small mod, which gets rid of the mass route that happens at the end of battle. This is something that has always annoyed me, especially when playing as or fighting undead armies. Why would your vampire lord crumble at the end of the battle into nothing less because his zombies were defeated? Zombies are made to be defeated, it should not make your lord disintegrate. Additionally, with living armies in real historical warfare, armies on opposite sides of the battlefield fought independently of one another. They did not know that their comrades across the battlefield were being butchered, so they would not rout because of that. The penalty for generals dying or fleeing has also been greatly increased. 1. This is more realistic, as when there are no generals left, units would take a large morale hit. Additionally, without the mass rush from the game, you can end up having to chase down a few units of hardly any people at the end of a battle when the opponent is clearly defeated. If you kill or rout their general now, units will not have much reason to come back from their routing stance when they are mostly demoralized anyway, because there is not even a commander. This should be compatible with everything in the sense that I made it high priority, so it should overwrite anything that also edits that database and try. That's very good. in the original game and in some mods, most armies route very fast, and it's annoying to just watch like a hunt where the winner hunts the routing troops across the battlefield. And the worst thing, in my opinion, was the siege battles. When you won a siege battle, they wouldn't fight to the last man like in Medieval 2. Instead they would escape the battlefield into some inner part of the city that is outside of the playable area, and I really really dislike that. I like siege battles to be battles to the death, so it doesn't make sense that they can actually escape from a siege battle. They should fight to the bitter end. And by removing the mass route, we fixed the issue with armies fleeing on the battlefield. But it still happens, but it's far from as common. It doesn't happen all the time and very soon after the battle started. But this mod didn't fix the siege battles, so I've used another mod to try and fix that. Because, of course, if you have surrounded a city and are laying siege to it and then you attack it, and the defenders would not be able to escape, and they should, all things considered, fight to the death. But instead they would manage to somehow flee, and that destroyed it for me, I think. Alright, and then we have more compatible Zebedee's Realistic Flight, more compatible. Zebedee's Realistic Flight, yeah. It adds more realistic flight animations to all the flying units, with the exception of maybe one or two new ones, alright. And then we have no more stupid animations for all races, compatible with everything, affects custom units. Let's see here. Factions affected, Empire, Norska, all elves, Lizardmen, Tomb Kings, Dwarves. And notice, apparently this affects Tomb Kings and any other units that use Hut, Huvan, Sword Shield, Bretonnian, some vampire units like Grave Guards. Animations in Sierra uses a lot of animations across some factions. Compatible with everything, including custom units, since they always use vanilla animations. This mod may be the first of its kind, editing animation files and not land unit table. I did this by making copies of the normal attack animations and renaming those copies to overwrite the stupid ones. Alright. So, spear and shield armed troops now only use their spear to attack. No more jumping into the enemy force and leaving formation. Also no more kicking. Why would you kick something when you can stab it from a distance? They will still use shield bash every now and then, but I made it less likely. Sword and shield guys no longer do the ballerina spin and suicide dive into enemy formations. And for charges, they now do a jab or shield bash. Empire lords and another sword and shield lord that uses empire animes no longer jump into the middle of the enemy and will now stay in formation with troops and cut people from the safety of their own lines. Alright, yeah, this mod removes the more flash animations and makes animations more believable, more realistic. I know it's a fancy game, but I kinda like this because it's more like in Medieval 2, which I think has the best battles, but not the best animations and not the best graphics, but the best, what should I say, realism. Alright, Immersive skin updated for the Warden of the, and the Punch, all credits, blah blah blah. So we have some better skins for some units here. The beautiful Spell Singer, Pretty Damsel, Righteous Knight, Impressive Green Knight, Graceful Fae Enchantress, Mighty Paladin, Feminine Prophetess. Prophetess. Alright, so pretty much the Bretonnia units have been made more beautiful. Alright, and then we have a reskin of Dark Elves. The Dark Elves are now dressed in armor as black as their hearts. For most units, metal armor is now gold and charcoal black. Most fabric is also black, except for subtle color accents. Chainmail remains bright silver. The Hydra is also much darker, like the one shown in the Dark Elves loading screen painting. Alright. And the Witch Elves have black hair instead of the white or grey, which I like. They look younger with black hair. I don't know why they used white in the vanilla game. Alright, and then we have no light beams. A simple mod that disables the light beams for all wizards, lords and heroes in the game. Good for screens and some more immersive battles. I got this after watching Surreal Beliefs. He used this mod, so I thought it was a good idea. I added most of the mods he used. Alright, we have beautiful death sags. We'll increase the looks of Kalida, Morati, Lariel, sisters. No, that's other mods. Better death hag textures, face tattoos removed, fairer skin, whiter hair, fading to faction color. Overall, not much changed. Alright, it improves the death hags. Alright, sisters of Avalorn have become more beautiful. And more beautiful war dancers for the wood elves. We can't use brutal battles because they aren't compatible. We with other mods. We have improved arrow trails. This was very important. I really hate in Shogun, Total War Shogun 2 and all the other games that followed, that the arrows look very bad. They are like white beams instead of like in Medieval 2 and Rome Total War where they looked like arrows. So this mod pretty much makes arrows and crossbow fire arrows more like they were in Medieval 2 and Rome 2, so they look like in those games when they fire, and that's very good. This mod removes the huge distracting white arrow trails and replaces them with thin Medieval 2 style trails. The pictures don't do the mod justice, so download it and see for yourself. Yeah, I really wanted this because that's what I dislike about arrows in all the games after Medieval 2. And this mod returns the arrows to how they should look, but unfortunately this mod is not for the other games. I would love to add an arrow trails improved mod for all the other games as well that use that white distracting arrow trail, because they should really look like in Medieval 2. Alright, one, rifle trails are updated alongside arrow trails, so now they have updated it with rifle trails as well, and wood elf arrows, javelins, flaming and poison arrows, trails reduced, impact effects for all wood elf arrows removed, flaming and poison impact trails removed. Updated all standard arrow trails to be more visible from a distance. They're a bit easier to see now. Updated vampire units and DLC units from the Queen and the Chronology. So we have no degradation, persistent summons. So pretty much in some factions can summon units in the battle, and in the vanilla game they would disappear after a while, like in Battle for Middle Earth when you summon like a Balrog or Valman of Dunwen, they would disappear after 10 minutes, after 10 seconds or something, 30 seconds maybe. In this game there was a similar feature where you can summon, as we can see here, Skaven, and then they would disappear after a while. This mod removes the time limit, so they will stay and fight for the rest of the battle. You won't lose the unit, which makes sense and makes it more realistic. And uniforms and heraldry of Bretonnia will add new. This will add new looks for Bretonnia, I guess. Uniforms and heraldry. Alright. Always fast forward. This makes it so that we can fast forward during the end turn. So they are very fast. Uniforms and heraldry of the Empire. So we get new uniforms and heraldry for the Empire. And then beautiful compilation. It's a compilation which includes all of these: beautiful sisters of the Torm, beautiful spell singers, war dancers, witch elves, death hags, sorceresses, beautiful supreme sorceresses, beautiful sisters of slaughter, archmages, handmaidens, princesses, mages, sisters of Avalorn. So pretty much all the elves, both high elves and dark elves, have their beautiful versions. So in case I missed anyone, then we have the AI general 2 spectator mod advanced, which is very cool. It enables me to place every unit under AI control. Shift plus F9 will enable the AI for all selected units. Shift plus F10 will enable the AI for all unselected units. And advanced controls turn unit responses on off. So shift plus F11 will turn all the unit responses off, which is good, so we don't have to hear like the sources chanting the same words over and over again. And turn AI control of summon units on off. Turn AI control of summon units on off, so we can choose if we want the summon units to be AI controlled or not. Turn AI control of rallying units on off, so if we have, you can assign all rallying units to the AI. This means that you normally control your units until they rout. Once they rally, they will be controlled by AI. To enable this, function assign a key to, yeah, all right. So that's a very cool mod that I'm using. We are using the spectator mode advanced. There were also the spectator mode, but it wasn't as good. All right, Catap's green skins, thief currency. Traditionally, orcs and their subordinates mostly use teeth as currency. Not only it is blood of the orc gear than the shiny stuff used by other races, so wealthy orc is guaranteed to have collected his income through means of proper bashing and looting. Teeth also bring the added value of being able to be spontaneously generated in other orcs' mouths. Ready for collection. So the orc currency is teeth of conquered factions. So if they take an area from the humans, they will bash their teeth out and use the human teeth to trade. And this mod adds teeth, which is called thief in Warhammer, in the orc language. It adds thief as the currency. It's pretty cool. I thought it would be good for immersion. And then we have alternate lightning. This mod brings Total War Warhammer 2 lightning closer to Total War Warhammer 1, darker and less colorful. All right, that's good for immersion. Needs improved loading screen artwork, so we have better loading screens here. This mod replaces the dark default loading screens to a lot more pretty and lore friendly with artwork from Warhammer series. All right, yeah, it's also for the immersion. Closer to action battle camera. This mod purpose is keeping you close to the battles and action. Some may prefer higher camera angles and some may not. I always like to be in close to the action. This layer. So we have better camera mode, so we can get closer to the action. We have unliving dismemberment fix. Fixes the dismemberment for undead units. Select Tomb Kings, Vampire Coast, and Vampire Count units can now keep fighting after losing limbs. This is out of the vanilla version. If the undead lost body parts, they couldn't keep fighting, but now they can, which is of course more true to them being undead. They aren't alive. They won't feel any pain. They won't rout. They are never scared. If they lose a hand or a finger, won't matter. It's like a zombie in a horror movie. If you cut off the hand, it won't kill the zombie, but if you crush the brain, then it would die. Alright, and then we have easy diplomacy, which could be seen as a cheat mod, because it enables me to, if I pay 300 gold, the AI will accept any deal. I used it back when I didn't have the legendary lords. Because I like making all the Dark Elves my allies, but now we will start with the entire faction and play as the entire faction, and the AI will have the others be entire factions. We won't really need this, but it's still pretty cool. Easy diplomacy. Maybe we'll turn it off actually, because now we will use the other mod. Maybe we could use it in case there are some revolts or something. I hate that. Alright, GCCM2 custom assets. So Grand Campaign custom map 2 custom assets. Alright, this is a compilation that includes 50 buildings restored from Total War Warhammer 1 that CA only included partially in Total War Warhammer 2. So we get lot of buildings from Warhammer 1 restored. Collection of custom decals made by Maruka. 5 custom buildings by Frodo, 45-12-7. Those Flammenwerfer Geis are one of them. 5 custom buildings, I see. 64 Kislevite style custom buildings by Maruka. 5 custom buildings by Maruka. And for modders only, all seat buildings, gatehouses, towers, walls, unlocked by Terran. Alright. That's some additional assets right there. We have a Grand Campaign custom map main mod. It's a cool mod. You can see here, what's this? This is GCCM, or Grand Campaign Custom Maps. It's a mod that brings custom map to the campaign, the goal of increasing visual and gameplay variety, because as I said, all the settlements of the map, no matter what race, use the same boring layout. CA was really lazy with the settlement battles in Warhammer 2 and in Warhammer 1, because it's like a cool city in the background, and then it's just a simple layout where you fight like a square, and every battle was the same. So this mod adds custom settlements to the map to make the settlement battles of those custom settlements much more unique and varied. And as we can see, this map shows how many have been changed. Here we have a custom area, we have the capital of Dark Elves is now custom. We have two areas in Ultion. We have two areas down here. We have some areas in Lustria. We have lots of areas in Britannia, in the Norskan homelands, in Skaven areas, in Dwarven areas, and in Empire areas, and also down here, Orcs, etc. So, lots of custom maps have been added. See more closely here. Custom maps. So when we fight battles in those areas, they will not be vanilla, which is very good. Unfortunately, most of the custom settlements are on this side of the map, and as the Dark Elves, we are controlling pretty much all of this, but we might have a battle here, and then it will be down here and against the High Elves. So. But if we are attacked, there will most be vanilla settlements here. Only the capital of Naggarond is a custom city out of the Dark Elf cities. That's a little boring. I hope they will, in the end, replace every settlement. They said that's the goal, but we never know how far they will get. Because they are modding for free, so. This is a very cool mod. Made siege battles a little more fun, at least when you a lot more fun if you fight in those battles. We have a clear skies mod, reduce the amount of fog present on the campaign map. That's great. Brutal sieges couldn't be used. Karak minor settlement siege. Dwarven Karak is under siege from the greenskin horde. Davi must sell out and fight them. This is a minor settlement siege with a dwarven team. The map supports 4v4 custom and multiplayer battles. There are AI hints, but it is more epic and better to play on multiplayer against other players. Alright, so this is a custom settlement only for multiplayer and custom battles. Dwarven one. And the darker Grand Campaign. This mod changes both the Vertex map and the Mortal Empires map to a much darker and grittier Warhammer experience. Yeah, because I like dark and gritty, so we replaced the old colorful map with a more dark one. Currently the Mortal Empires version is a work in progress, but I thought I'd share with you guys what I have completed so far. If you have any suggestions, please post below. Alright. And then we have Gore Galore, because I like gore. So update, I'm testing a new Battlefield Blood mod. This removes the FPS crippling blood explosions. That's good. There were too many blood explosions in the past. But makes blood show up much more on the ground. I like that. After a battlefield there should be lots of blood on the ground. I hate that a unit getting hit by a catapult with the unit just getting back up and there is no blood on the ground. So this is cool, it looks something like this. Alright, movement zone recolor, green. I hated the yellow color for the movement area for an army. So I finally figured out how to change it. So now it's green like in Medieval 2, that's very good. Kislev City Brawl, Grand Campaign, custom map. Alright, this is a battle map of Kislev City. The map is the largest map made so far for Total War, Warhammer 1 or 2, and that was in January 26, 2020. Really hope you enjoy it. Alright, so it's a very large map. I'm not, it's probably in the campaign as well. But I think this is maybe for custom battles and multiplayer. The ones in the campaign are part of that compilation with a lot of settlements and features. Longer battles, they aren't supported, unfortunately. It can't be used alongside the other mods. Alright, more beautiful Hellebron. I like this one. Hellebron will look like this instead of the vanilla look, which is actually good looking. So that's what the mod does, the best one for Hellebron. And then we have make Medusae feral again. So this is a simpler skin mod that removes most of Medusae's war machine, also armor, that's all. Doesn't change the armor of that renowned regiment version of it though. So it changes the Medusa so that she doesn't have armor and will have boobs, etc. Yeah, she's more sexy, I like that, so I will use that as well. And then Cleavers for Warhammer 2. It will add what this mod does. Grants Britonia peasant archers and mounted yeoman archers a quiver on their back. Grants High Elf, Lottern, Sea Guard, Mistwalker Sentinels and Illyrian Reavers a quiver on their back. Grants Dark Elf, Dark Riders, Magazines, Chariot Riders and Shade Units a magazine on their hips. Grants Tomb King Chariots Riders. Grants Tomb King Chariot Riders a quiver on their hips. Grants Crossbowmen a quiver on their hips. So that's cool. Adds quivers to some units. And we have a magazines for the Dark Elves. I'm pleased to give you my fourth mod for Warhammer 2. And it's once again a quiver mod. So it adds this quiver to the Dark Elven units. That's cool in case a unit were missed. We have the unit LOD remover. This mod completely removes the unit's LOD scaling. No more terrible looking low poly models when you zoom away from soldiers. Very good for movie screenshots and for battles too if your PC can handle it. Note, it's a big performance hit, so I wouldn't recommend using this mod on a potato PC, only for beefy machines. Disabling AA, anti-aliasing may help. So yeah, we're using that. I have a gaming computer from 2009, but with with a motherboard and a processor and etc. from 2012. I pretty much replaced everything inside of the chassis in 2012, and then the graphic card broke in 2013 because I was I fucked up and I bought a new one, and it was the best graphic card on the market back in like October or September 2013. The computer is getting old, but it's a Windows 7 and it's still good enough to, you know, play Medieval 2 and stuff like that without lag on the best graphics. And in this case, in Total War Warhammer 2, if I use the ultra settings when it comes to unit size, then it will lag, especially when you have Skaven on the battlefield. So I won't use the ultra settings, we will use the large unit size. And also if I use the anti-aliasing X16, then it will also be kind of slow. So we will use the X8, I meant. Yeah, we used X4, then the mod, the game works very good, very well. Okay, proper undead, let's take a look at this. Zombies, sword, infantry, good binding, animated state hold battle. Animated state hold battle, what does that mean? Do you ever ask yourself why my undead army get tired? They are undead, alright. They do not know the fatigue and should relentless hunt enemies until they die. My mod is Tendrastish and now vampire units are tireless. So they never tire, that's cool. Makes the undead more like undead. Then we have the two great mods, the Radius Total War mod, part 1 and 2. So you can see here, overview from the award-winning team and from the creators of the most subscribed mods on Steam Workshop for TV games, Total War games, comes another major modification. This time for brand new Total War Warhammer 2, Radius Warhammer Total War mod. So we have new units, over 200 new units, over 200 new unique units for all factions, based on lore, balance to fit between vanilla units. That's good. Popular coop and multiplayer. Jump in with your friends and enjoy the master campaigns together, or just play multiplayer battles. Yeah, in Total War Warhammer 2 you can play a campaign together with one other person. And it's not a hot seat campaign. You will sit on your own computer and the other player will sit on his, and then you will fight. It's like playing a multiplayer battle in older titles, but instead you can play a campaign that way. I believe it was possible in Napoleon Total War as well, so since Napoleon it might have been a feature, but I've never really used that feature. Yeah, but it's pretty cool. Problem is that other players are so good at the strategic gameplay that it will be very hard to win against them in battles. That's why I prefer fighting the AI. And then we have overhauled campaign mechanics. Factions enhanced to be far more unique than their vanilla counterparts, with new features, rebalanced effects, and much more. Overhauled magic, all spells, mana, and abilities are rebalanced to offer wider variety and more intriguing system. Overhauled economy, reworked the entire system, income rebalanced and upkeep reduced to allow players and AI to field more armies, more expensive buildings and units. Alright. Then we have overhauled AI and script. Campaign AI entirely reworked, more aggressive, better army composition. Chaos and Beastman script changed to be more challenging and interesting to combat. New effects and garrisons. All new garrisons for all factions, which include vanilla and custom units. New effects for technologies, buildings, and much more. Lore friendly. Modifications are rooted in the Warhammer Fantasy universe and its lore. We reference Warhammer Fantasy battles, army books, and the history of the old world. And complete battle rebalance. Reworked stats for all units, lords, heroes, weapons, and armor to improve battle balance and enjoyment. Variety of submods. Massive fan involvement. Radius submods bring an unprecedented amount of tweaks and improvements to your game. So a lot of cool features, but that steel overhaul mod is also similar to this one, but has a bigger focus on making elite units elite and giants elite, and basic units are like, let's say in this game most units are similar, and none is really superior to the others. In Steel Overhaul mod, I believe they have made it more like focused on making elites impossible to defeat for the Saki troops, and if you have like ordinary troops, then they are very well balanced compared to each other. I haven't tried it, but it will be something I will do soon. But unfortunately, the mod is updating. The problem is that when mods in Total War Warhammer 2 and other modern titles, if the base main game on Steam will update automatically, and when that happens, all the mods for the game will stop working, because the modders will need to update the mod to be compatible with the changes of the new game. Can say the base game has become a new version, and for the old mods to work on the new version, you will need to update the old mods, and that's what they are doing now. But I read somewhere that the new Steel Fate overhaul mod will actually release today during Sunday. Today, but the date is Sunday 7th June 2020, right? But it hasn't released yet, so we are using Radius. Alright, so what more do we have here? We have the GOV's realistic siege, no center rush, very important. I hated when I played siege battles and armies would just rush the center, and in a minute or so they would win the battle because they took the center. This mod is removing that, so now they need to defeat the armies that are defending. Previously they just needed to rout them, but that is probably solved now as well. So that essential mod that makes siege battles actual siege battles and not capture the flag. So that tells everything basically. They can't just take the center to win anymore. And then we have a reskin of the Graceful Fey Enchantress, so it will look like this, much better than before. Skin of Pretty Damsel, might have been part of another mod, but I have them active just in case. Then we have zoom in, out camera. Doesn't sink beneath the ground, it prevents the camera from sinking beneath the ground of the units, very good. Have adjustable battle speed, but I believe it was kind of unstable, so I deactivated it. We have another spectator mode, advanced general AI spectator mode, so we don't need a spectator mode too, it isn't compatible with it. We have true sorceresses, so they will look like this, the sorceresses, and the Moratti hero will look like this, much better than the vanilla look. They looked like old hags previously, now they actually look younger and better. Alright, and ultimate unique Elven Lords plus variety pack. So we get some unique Elven Lords here with new looks and such. Updated a few portraits, removed shields from princes, completed to fix a bug with shields, added the two high elf mages as requested. Added some textures from Calembribar 21, they were so well done, yeah. Alright, so we get some new looks there. We have unit formations, a very cool mod. Ever wondered why there were no formations available for any units? Despite most races being disciplined well enough to use advanced tactics and thus formations, now you are able to give most units the order to get into formations of your choice, and as you would expect, they also get a bit better in combat by doing so. Formation availability. These formations are fully optional extra bit of micromanagement that gives you useful bonuses if you utilize them. But if you activate this mod and choose to not use them yourself, most AI factions will use some of them against you to provide more of a challenge. So we get a lot of cool formations for units. As we can see here, wedge formation, like shield wall and circle and a lot of stuff, and the AI can use them as well. They are taken from like Attila, I believe, the Total War Warhammer 2 mod game, and Total War Attila, Total War Rome 2, etc. They are very similar, so modders have managed to move over features from Attila to Total War Warhammer 2, like formations, because they weren't in the base Total War Warhammer 2 game, but they were in the base Total War Rome 2 and Attila games. Alright, and then we have better Medusa and Shrine. So this mod improves Medusa and Shrine. Range accuracy and other missile capabilities improved. Armor hit points and melee skills improved. Mass increased from 1300 to 2000. Attack speed increased. New contact effect added. So the Medusas will be more deadly. And I like that too. They are part of the Dark Elves. Unfortunately, called nearby ally army mod stopped to work, but that doesn't matter now when we are going to fight as the entire faction. We don't need to move allies then. Even though this feature worked for non-Dark Elven races as well. So it would still be cool to use, but yeah. All right, and we have Allies Return Land, which is a cool mod. This mod makes it so that every region the player owns gets registered at the end of the player's turn. And if an ally or a vassal of the player takes the region, whether it was first taken by a third faction or it was abandoned or razed, the ally will faithfully return it to the player rather than keep it to himself. This would make having allies a bit less painful, with having to deal with them colonizing random cities in the middle of the player's heartlands. Player loses to a random rogue army or any other reason, which in many cases forced player to enter a war with what was until now a faithful ally they had no intention of fighting. Alright, so that's cool. We can get back areas. That would be very useful if we play the game with the AI controlling the other Dark Elves, for example. But now we will control all of the Dark Elves, so it doesn't really matter unless we have allies of different races. But the Dark Elves are not allied with any other races. I believe in the Mark of Chaos expansion, where you could play as the Dark Elves, they were allied to the Orcs. So possibly you can ally the Dark Elves to the Orcs, but that's pretty much it. Alright, and we are not using the Lost Factions. It's the mods that add replace certain minor factions with new factions like the Halflings, the Amazons, etc. We are not using that because it's not compatible with the other mods I'm using. We have region trading. This mod adds a new UI which provides a basic version of region trading. Functionality currently includes purchasing and gifting of regions. The main reason this mod was added was to allow the player to obtain regions which have been taken by friendly AI factions, stopping the player from obtaining a complete province. Yeah, and that's also something that would be more useful when the Dark Elves were their own smaller factions. And this is a mod that improves on it, but needs the other one to function. This mod removes the restrictions from the region trading mod, allowing you to buy any province from any faction and gift to any faction. The other one will allow you to buy regions from allies or sell regions to allies. This one removes the restriction. Now you can buy from any race and sell to any race. Alright, and then we have culture restricted join war. This mod addresses two problems in the base game. One, the ability for players to routinely use join war to easily circumvent alliances and avoid having to suffer the diplomatic repercussions of declaring war. Two, the frequent immersion breaking dogpiling of unallied AI against player through the use of join war. Yeah, for example, if a Skaven and a High Elven army decides to join forces against the player, that's not very lore accurate. This was also a mod that was more useful when we had many smaller factions instead of a bunch of mega powerful ones. Alright, we have Abandoned Region, a mod. This mod brings back Total War Tilda's region abandoning feature, so we can abandon settlements, but I don't know how to do it. Therefore, this mod required the UI modding framework to work. Limitations since it is a UI feature, the AI can't make use of it yet, so it's only for the player. Two, abandoning a settlement is by default done on the same turn, unlike in Attila where it happens on the following turn. If you prefer the one turn delay, like in Attila, it is possible to change the setting to one turn delay using the mod configuration tool, which we will do. 3. You only receive 60% of the construction cost of the main settlement building. Same rule as the constructing a building. Alright. If you don't have to leave a settlement immediately, make sure to deconstruct its buildings before abandoning the region. Yeah, so we should deconstruct buildings before abandoning the region. 4. Every time you abandon a region, your faction suffers a public order penalty for 5 turns. Devastation is rather unpopular, yeah. I will make that local and not global. Settlements already under siege can't be abandoned. Alright, public order penalty for abandoning regions. Or no penalty, fixed public order penalty of -5, or public order penalty based on settlement tier, local or global. Local or global default public order penalty. Alright. This is pretty cool. Anyway, this mod. So, and then we have the UI modding framework required for a lot of the mods to work. This mod has a whole framework allowing the possibility of creating custom user interfaces within mods. Creating UIs within mods is notoriously difficult, which results in very few, if any, mods utilizing them. This framework unlocks this possibility by providing an easy mechanism to create them. This mod was originally based off of the Attila region trading mod. Alright. And then we have Lawful Great Power Beta. This mod replaces Great Power with something that makes more sense in a lore-friendly way for both player and the AI. So Great Power is when you have a Great Power in the game, you will get a penalty. So you can't really ally anyone. The diplomatic relations will suffer greatly. That's what is called the Great Power Penalty. And instead of that, they have done changes. Why not just remove Great Power? Great Power has many faults, but at its core has a good purpose. It's designed to encourage conflict between large factions and their neighbors. This mod seeks to achieve this goal in a less frustrating way. No longer will your long-time dwarven ally declare war on you, the Empire, for pacifying and colonizing Ultuan, home of their hated foe, the Elves. So how does it work? First off, the mod removes Great Power. You will no longer have increasing diplomatic penalties simply for owning lots of territory, which is very good. Instead, the mod creates diplomatic penalties based on territorial disputes. This is for the player and the AI. There are two types of dispute, the diplomatic penalties stack. Alright. So one, faction dispute. A faction believes a region should be owned by them specifically and will have a -8 diplomacy penalty to any faction that owns this region. In essence, Raikland, the faction, believes that the province of Raikland is theirs and theirs alone and will hate any other faction who occupies their lands. Resulting in war, hopefully. And then two, culture dispute. A faction believes that a region should be owned by someone of their culture and will receive -5 diplomacy penalty when any faction not of their culture who owns that region. In essence, all the Empire Electro Counts believe that Raikland should be owned by an Empire faction, but do not care which one. And who to any non-Empire faction who threatens this. In this way, as a faction naturally gains territory through expansion, they are more likely to conflict with other factions who feel they have a right to that land. This is shown as Ruler's Prejudice vs. X. Alright. Effects of the mod. 1. As the player, you can choose how you expand to respect your allied expectations. 2. Player or AI. Factions with disputed territory are more likely to have negative diplomacy. 3. Player or AI. When a faction expands into a new region, that region's culture are more likely to band together against the encroaching foe than get taken down one by one. That's very good, even if we had many minor factions, they would band together. Now they will start united, so it doesn't really matter there. And recommended mods, these will help you with region management, to band the region, which we are using a trade region, yeah. Immersive battle banners compatible pack. So we have some new banners on the battlefields and on the map. Cultural settlement skins, larger buildings, we have work in progress for the Warden and the Punch. So we have some better look, bigger and better looking settlements on the map. Buildings on the map are better looking and bigger. Cultural settlement skins, updated for the Warden and the Punch. The same, isn't it? Larger buildings, and that's just the ordinary, I think. Some similar, and blue and white high elves, the original color of the high elves are blue and white, so now they will all be blue and white, and as they are united, it will be the real high elven faction. we will be fighting. Or if we place them, they will look like that. And we have skip intro logos, a mod which will, when we start the game, we won't have to see the intro with Sega, etc. And grand campaign, custom maps, unique faction capitals. It will add unique looks to all the cities. When they upgrade, they will change. Like in Medieval 2, the capitals especially will look much better. Very good. Let's see here how it changes when you upgrade. And we have Black Crag. We have some Chaos War camps here. The Black Pyramid of the Tomb Kings. Lord Lothurn. See an Elven city there. Alright, so yeah. Makes things much better looking. Yeah, building progression icons too will make the building progression icons much more readable and easier to figure out. Darker and deeper sea will make the seas better looking, the water. Cleaner balance bar will make the balance bar between factions much more like the old Medieval 2 one, which I like. Soul dials and the old ones, I never figured this out. This will make it easier to handle these puzzles in the game, otherwise I would never know how to solve them. Alright, Zebedee's 2 points per level heroes makes it so that every time a hero, a strategic map hero on the map levels up, he gets 2 points instead of 1 to spend. And same with this Zebedee's 2 points per level lord. So every time a lord level up, he or she will get 2 points instead of 1. Zebedee's and Adu's all faction officers will add officers to all the units of the game, but I'm not sure it works actually. It might not work. And then we have Zebedee's no great power penalty, we didn't need that. Fast units, fast armies, it's outdated. This one is outdated, that's maybe why it might not work. So, we will still have it on in case it works, but I don't think it did. And then, decline diplomacy, updated for the Warden and the Punch. You can now out-tab to your heart's content during those long turn times, without worrying that those pesky doll that declared war on you again have stopped the end of the turn waiting for you to click OK. So it this button here makes it so you can fast forward during end turn, and this one makes it so that you will automatically decline any diplomacy offers. So if you leave the computer on during next turn, then they will automatically decline. That's pretty good. And then we have better LL unit cards, so you get better unit cards for all the heroes in the game. That's good. And Dread Spears better animation. I'm not sure it works, but the Dread Spears will have the same animation as the High Elves, which is much better. And then we have the Zebedee's unit resize, which resizes all the units to be varied. For example, a unit of Witch Elves, where each Witch Elf will have different like height, so all of them won't be the same length or height or whatever, they will be in varied sizes, and this is true for beasts too, like trolls. Alright, and Ticker Dust and Smoke 2, improved dust and smoke settings, contain also a few extra enhanced trails files as optional, so better graphics for smoke, etc. Alright, and dust. No extra upkeep, so when we recruited new lords, we would get more upkeep, but this removes the upkeep when we recruit new lords, so that's good. More naval movement range, so this enables ships to move further distances instead of having the same distance as the land armies. It's like in older titles where the ships could move further than land armies. And Black Orcs immune to attrition. This mod makes Black Orcs immune to attrition. One allows Black Orc replenish at contested hostile waters allows Black Ark replenish at contested hostile waters in Dread Expansion stands. So if the Black Ark is in Dread Expansion stands, in its Dread Expansion stands, then it will automatically regain its health through this replenish feature. Alright, and 2 increases replenishment rate from 4% to 10% in docked stands. So if it is in docked stands, in a harbor or something, then it will have 10% replenishment rate instead of 4. And 3 compatible with Steel Fate overhaul mode. Alright. And then we have no army losses. This is a very interesting mod. This mod removes the army losses morale penalty from the game to get more entertaining ends of to battles. This mod should be compatible with everything. So in essence, I hope this will fix the issue with heroes retreating in siege battles to the outside of the playable area. I hope that it will make them fight to the death. That's what I hope, at least. It removes army losses morale penalty. So when an army is losing units, it suffers a morale penalty, which causes the units to rout. And hopefully this also affects the heroes. That's what I'm hoping. Alright, and then we have no more rogue armies. So I've removed the spawning rogue armies. He says, I just got tired of seeing major races getting destroyed on the map by rogue armies. They're not exactly lawful, and some of the armies that spawn are just ridiculously overpowered to where normal factions controlled by AI just won't be able to counter them. Yeah, I don't want them either. They would interfere with the factions that are there from the start in the campaign. So we have activated that mode to remove the rogue armies that spawn. And then we have better war targets, but it's outdated, so I'm not sure it will work. But in this game, if you are allied to someone, you can decide that they should attack a certain region through war targets. When I think about it, that feature is the join war feature, so it might be removed. But if it isn't removed and you have this on, then it will change the priority of ally war targets. AI will attack it more often, because usually they wouldn't do straight, but now they will. So better war target if the war target function works. However, I am using other mods that probably interfere with that. We will deactivate it. And we didn't need no morale. It's my backup plan. If no army losses doesn't work, then this one might. It will make it so that all the units and heroes of the game has no morale issues, so they will fight to the death. But it's not good if you fight, for example, the Skaven, and all the rats never rout. It will make them pretty strong. Also, it would remove from the undead their advantage of never routing. So I don't want to use this unless the other one doesn't work. Alright, and Force Confederation is an alternative to the Legendary Confederation mod, but I prefer that one. And then regions full visibility, so we can see own regions will be visible, of course, and regions of the military allies, regions of the defensive allies will not be visible, but we can configure it so that they will be visible. Regions of the vassals will be visible, etc., etc. Makes it campaign more visible, and no campaign map FOV or fog. this mod simply removes the fog that is everywhere on the campaign map. Works both for the Immortal Empires and Vertex campaign. Does not remove fog in the far distance, which is there to hide LOD, and pop-in does not affect fog of war. So we won't be able to see enemies or neutral factions far away, but we can see the map. There are no more blackness. Removes the blackness, that's good. Alright, so we're done. We'll have to try the Steel Fate overhaul later when it's updated, as it would release today. But for now, we will use this mod and start the game. So let's start the game. You're playing with these mods. Yeah. And let's play.